You go better than Kessler. But
one more time.
The computer just spot on time has gone into sleep mode. Yep. Welcome to Multipath TCP. Hello, everybody. I'm Philip Eardley, and Yoshifumi is sitting here with me. So Rolf has agreed to take the notes. Thank you very much. Are you going to take them in Etherpad?
Yeah.
So he's going to take them in the Etherpad. You can find the link from the meeting material. So if somebody wants to help him out or add in names that he doesn't know or whatever, then I'm sure that would be very welcome. Now, is anybody prepared to monitor Jabber? You're doing Jabber, thanks, Yoshifumi. And the normal reminders about please saying your name at the mic, please adding MPTCP in your drafts, and the blue sheets. I think we just did one then. So the blue sheet is on its way. And here's the note, well, as usual. So we've got a nice agenda today. So we'll quickly do the normal status update. The working group item we've got on the go at the moment is our protocol BIS document, which there's a few updates to discuss. We've got a couple of individual drafts or individual contributions. I think they're drafts, they're kind of papers and stuff to do with security, which we thought would be interesting to discuss. That's something that may or may not impact the BIS, but it's a good time to discuss those new proposals. Then want to have a discussion kind of how we complete the BIS. We're conscious as chairs that it's been going on quite a long time, so we want to try and have a discussion about how we can complete it. There are then a couple of presentations, Joseph talking about the NAS work and Keane talking about some SIN duplication work, which he's presented before, but some update results. Joseph and Keane, are you both here? Joseph, hey, and Keane, great, excellent. So then the rest of the time we'll be talking about proxies, which is something that's been on the agenda for a number of years. People have had various work at various stages, and we want to try and see if we can actually work out how to progress some of it. There's kind of been individual contributions over, say, probably at least 5 years on and off. There's been different contributions about this topic, and it seems one where there really is interest in the vendor and operator world to do something, and we should try and work it out. So we're going to try and have a sort of narrowish discussion on a particular scenario and see if we can make any progress. And hopefully to help rather than hinder that, we have a nice tea break in the middle, tea and cake break in the middle, or coffee and cookies if you prefer. So on the status update, the experience draft has been published. Thank you very much to Olivia and friends for that. The BIS document we're going to talk about, and just our normal opportunity for anybody who wants to share any implementation news. I don't know if anybody has implementation news that they are able to share. I know people do implementation work that they sometimes want to share and sometimes don't. Christoph, excellent.
Christoph, in Linux, we have now progressed the implementation up to kernel version 4.4, and we will be making a new release soon that is based on kernel 4.4. In terms of implementation of RFC 6824 BIS, I started the implementation of the new handshake, and it's looking fine. It seems to be doable. It's not that complicated. It adds a little bit of complexity. I have some comments that I took note of that should probably be clarified inside the inside the draft, and I will send out an email when I'm done with the implementation and have reviewed my comments.
Do you have any rough time milestone? Sorry. Do you have any rough milestone?
What time scale might you do?
Like, I will send on an email next week. Okay. What is actually still remaining in the implementation to do in terms of RFC 6824 biz is updating the address 2 option. We already have an implementation of it, but I think it needs to be reviewed. And then the MPTSP reset is also not implemented. And then I think just going over the draft and making sure that we are compliant in all cases. But for the handshake, I hope I can send out a confirmation next week that it's done, and then I will work on open sourcing it as well.
Excellent. That's good news. Thank you. Anybody else want to share any implementation news? Okay. Alan, you're up next, aren't you?
This is an unusual position over here.
You can take it out and row if you want.
No, I've got to be good staying this. I've got to stay in this. Very short update, I think, on this. But I say very short. In terms of actual document update, next slide, please. There is nothing, because we haven't updated anything since Seoul. Thanks to someone who pointed out some typos, they are corrected in the non-published version. Other than that, there's nothing else changing, but we need to decide what, if anything else, is added to the base spec. So next slide. One thing that was raised by Olivier, I think, and a couple of other people, was we should really get rid of our SHA-1 dependencies in the document. So even though we're quite heavily truncating the hashes anyway in the way it's used, it obviously makes sense to go for a stronger hash algorithm, and also just remove any dependencies on legacy code from the spec anyway. Not least, no one would accept a standard track document with SHA-1 in anyway. So this is one thing. Upon basic investigation, it is a simple search and replace pretty much for any reference to SHA-1 to SHA-256. I don't see a problem with that. I don't think anyone else has commented on the list about seeing a problem with that, but we still need a consensus call, I guess, on doing it. Jazz.
Yeah, we didn't get any response from security people about
that. Right. And I would like to get the feedback from the media. Is the media in this room?
No, not made it yet.
Okay.
So I don't know. Do we? How best to proceed? Do we try and do a consensus call on the list before we do this, or do we just do it, or hum in the room, or what do we do?
Does anybody in the room have any objection to changing to 256, or better ideas? So I think we should make sure it's okay with, try and get a response out of me and some security people, but I think just go ahead is the default.
Okay, thank you. Next slide. So the other set of changes that have been proposed in various forms were from Fabienne on the list, various things to make things better in load balance scenarios, security scenarios, reliability, and so on. These go back actually all the way back to Berlin in the main, but again, these are all things we're just trying to get finished, rubber stamped and so on now, so we can say there isn't anything else left to do on the draft. Proposal one was about the do not use the address for subflow establishment. We adopted that one. The reliability of the add option, we adopted that one because both of those had reasonable support and no dissent on the list. Proposal three, we didn't yet adopt. This was the idea about differentiating between make before break and break before make on additional addresses. Christoph spoke in favor of it. No one else did on the list. Just as a reminder, this is an idea that we would, at the moment, you can set up a subflow and then send an MP prior on it to say, use this if nothing else is available. So use it as a backup. But this is almost using a second tier of that by saying, don't even set up a connection to this address unless you need to. I don't know if there's any comments on the room on that one. The thread is quite old on the mailing list. We can obviously resurrect it after the meeting, but I don't know if anyone had any memories or comments on it now. I'm especially looking in Christoph's direction, but anyone who has anything. You spoke in favor, and you're still in favor. Okay.
By the way, Harvey's draft is already expired. So if you ask the comments on the core question for the draft, and maybe, I don't know, you should send a pointer.
Yeah.
So are there any other views on this proposal, either in favor or against, or anybody who wants to express a view that is, I don't care?
I think we'll resurrect it on the list, this one, because I think there is, I'm neutral on it. There seems reasonable arguments for doing it. It seems useful, but useful just to know if there's more than one person who's particularly keen on it. The final two proposals did not get a huge amount of support on the list at all. I'm just really putting them up here as a reminder to people that these things were on the list, they were being proposed. If anyone has any thoughts, anyone has any desire to speak out in favor of them, then please do, because otherwise they won't get in the draft. If you're interested in getting them in the draft, then please speak out. And that's it. Move on then, next slide.
Yeah, so we won't include those final two unless something happens.
We'll prod on the list again, just emphasize that this is where we are with these proposals and just see if anyone has any further thoughts. But I'm getting the impression probably not. This is all expired, but I kind of, since I'm standing here, I want to make another point about it. This was Christoph and my proposal that from a little while ago, just another reminder that we were keen to get something in the base spec here, but it didn't have a huge amount of support. But just as a refresher, this was our idea to separate the crypto scheme used for the authentication from the tokens. So you only exchange tokens. Oh, just to be clear, sorry, this is an option. This isn't changing the whole protocol to do this, but because in the handshake you can do selection of crypto algorithm, this would be using one bit of the algorithm agility bits we've got to select this proposal rather than the SHA proposal as stands. So by decoupling the keys and the tokens, you only exchange the tokens in the MP capable, and anything that requires any authentication, such as MP join, would be delegated up to the application layer to be authenticated based on some crypto information that's sent. Deliberately left woolly for anything to be put in the base spec there, and left to other implementations and specifications and applications as to how to do it at the application layer. At the application layer, our main use case here would be for TLS, where you could use TLS key exporters to authenticate MP joins afterwards. So you could use the tokens for arbitrary data for load balancing and improve security by removing the keying material from the wire. As I said, we raised this, I think, in Berlin. We've discussed it a little bit on the list. Again, since we're trying to move close to the end of the BIS, just wanted to resurrect this and see again if anyone had any opinions, thoughts, desire or not for this proposal and wanted to say anything about it. Any support or lack of support?
Comments from Java, from Olivier.
Mm-hmm.
Application layer authentication. I would suggest to discuss that with TLSA 1.3 now that it has progressed enough.
Okay, so Olivier's saying you want to do with TLS 1.3. Again, that would seem perfectly good, but the actual use of the proposal existed was that the actual use of the algorithm the TLS would be out of scope for the base spec. The base spec is simply saying, if this is selected, it's delegated to the application, and then the application would use TLS or whatever to do the authentication. Any other thoughts, comments? That was quite quick then, let's move on. I'll also raise all that stuff up on the list as well. So is there anything else we're forgetting that we might want to edit, add whatever to the draft? Well, not so much edit, but add to the draft from a technical point of view at this point. Any implementation experience that needs to be accounted for? Anything in the signaling that would help an implementer or would help a scenario? Tumbleweed.
I think we will take that. Nobody has any comments on this?
Well,
that was so easy. I think definitely, yeah, prod those things on the list. Thanks,
yep,
Anna.
Will do.
And let's find the next one. Question. Oh, somebody wants to. Oh, hey, we get to push the button. No, they've disappeared.
Who was it? Oh. Olivier. Okay. Come back, Olivier. Yeah, there we go.
You can push the button. There we go.
Hello. So I was just in my presentation, I will have something that could be added to the draft, or at least a starting point for something that could be discussed in RFC 68 and 24 bits. So there will be some information in my presentation.
Okay, great. Look forward to it.
So don't make him here because he's up next.
Up. Over we go.
If I can find the right one. Olivia, your slide is up, so you're on. Perfect timing.
Okay, so thank you. So this is a, can you move to the next slide? So that's a presentation in two parts. The first one is a direction that I think we should progress to improve multipass TCP on smartphones, because smartphones are an important use case for multipass TCP. And then I will discuss briefly the multipass TCP secure, which is a paper that will appear in a few months and which could be of interest when we will look at to merge MPTCP and TCP crypt. But this is for further work. So next slide, please. So if we look at multipass TCP on smartphone, one can see that the main benefits that was discussed in the list was that you can get higher bandwidth by bonding Wi-Fi and LTE. But if you look at real smartphone applications, this is rarely the case. And most smartphone applications do not transmit a lot of data. What the smartphone application expects is that they want to have faster handovers between Wi-Fi and LTE. And I think that's the main reason why Apple is using MPTCP for Siri. Next slide. So if you look at what's happening with multipass TCP on smartphone, typically what you have is that one solution is that you can enable both LTE and Wi-Fi together. If you do that and you enable both, then what will happen is that you will start the connection over, say, the blue subflow, which corresponds to the Wi-Fi. Then you create MP join over the green subflow, which corresponds to the LTE, and say you set the LTE as a backup because LTE is more expensive than the Wi-Fi. And once you have a failure of the Wi-Fi, you can re-inject the data over the LTE network. So this is something that you can do, and this is something that works today. But the drawback is that you have to enable both LTE and Wi-Fi, which costs in energy on the smartphone and which costs in radio resources in the network. Next slide. So a different solution would be to delay the utilization of the LTE. So the scenario would be that you start the connection over the Wi-Fi network. And you see, it is when you detect that there are issues on the Wi-Fi network, that you have to retransmit data, for example, that you decide to enable the LTE. And once you have enabled the LTE, then you need to do an exchange with a SYNMP join and an exchange of four packets, which costs you two round-trip times over the LTE network. before being able to re-inject the data. And this is pretty long. If you have a delay sensitive application, and there are many delay sensitive applications on the smartphones, you don't want to lose that time to re-establish the LTE connection. Next slide, please. So ideally, what smartphones would like to be able to do is that they would like to be able to start the multipath TCP connection over the Wi-Fi network. And then when you lose data, then they would enable the LTE, and they would like to be able to re-inject the data immediately inside the MP join. So when you send a SYN to create the connection, you should be able to re-inject the data immediately so that you have zero RTT re-injection. And today, this is not possible because when we design MPTCP, we left the possibility of putting data in the SYN out of scope. But I think we should revisit that now that we are moving to RFC 6824 bits. Next slide, please. So that's, I think we should look at that. This is not a simple problem because we have to consider the security impact of putting data inside the SYN plus MP join, because we don't want to open a new attack vector for attackers. But I think there are possible solutions to do that, and we should explore that and maybe solicit suggestions for the next meeting in July, so that we can see whether we can include that inside the RFC 6824 bits. Next slide, please. So now the second part is multipath TCP secure. So next slide. So we have explored the issue of securing multipath TCP.
Do you want to ask a question?
You want
just a second, Olivia. We've got a question.
I have a question. Hey, this is Yoshi from Flora. So I have a very, naive question for the first one. So how about, in order to modify the MP join, how about establishing the connection beforehand? And then making to not use the LTE connection unless, if you need to use it.
So if I understand correctly, you want to always create the LTE connection.
Right, that's another way to solve the situation.
Yeah, but the problem if you do that, if you always create the LTE connection, is that on the smartphone, most of the connections are very short. And so you end up in creating lots of useless smartphone connections, lots of useless connections over the LTE network that do not carry any data. And basically, you enable your LTE interface just in case the Wi-Fi would get out. And so you consume a lot of energy to only transmit SYN and FIN packets.
Christoph, I like the idea of sending data inside the SYN for the MP join, because that way we can directly go ahead. Now, with the story of creating the subflow later and leaving the cellular link basically unused, I think the latency that we win by avoiding basically the handshake before we can send data is much lower than the time it takes to bring the cellular link up when it was completely idle. So basically the gain in terms of latency, I think, will not be that big in the end.
Yeah, but you can use the LTE in different modes, and there are modes where you can keep the LTE open, but you don't expect to be able to send or receive data very frequently, and this does not consume a lot of energy. And in that state, you win from a delay viewpoint.
True, yeah, you can keep it in the RC connected mode.
Yeah.
Keep going, Olivier.
Okay, so next slide on multipath TCP secure. So if you look at what are the solutions that we can use today to secure multipath TCP, you can run TLS over multipath TCP. And if you run TLS over multipath TCP, it works out of the box. but there are some attack scenarios that are not taken into account by TLS because TLS was not designed for a multipass environment. And typically with TLS, if you have an attacker which is able to change TCP address or MPTCP options or inject or modify data, then on any of the subflows, then the attacker will cause a denial of service attack over the connection. With multipass TCP secure, what we have tried to do is that we try to preserve the connectivity when the attacker is active on only some of the paths, but not all the paths that are available. So typically what we do with MPTCP secure is like what the congestion control does. So we try to move traffic away from the path where there is an attacker that can interfere with the multipass TCP connection. So next slide, please. So the attack scenario for TLS over multipass TCP is that, for example, you have the attacker on the Wi-Fi interface. And if the attacker changes the payload, then the receiver will detect an invalid TLS record, and the reaction is to terminate the entire TLS session, and the application is informed of the problem. Next slide, please. With multipass TCP.
We just lost you for a moment, Olivier. Can you come and come back in the queue? Are you in it or not?
No, I'm not. Oh, yeah, now it's come back. My session is come back. Olivier.
Is it okay?
We've lost Olivier. We're just trying to work out what's happened. Oh, you're back. You're back, Olivier.
Okay. Yeah. Good. So when you have the attacker with multipass TCP secure, then the receiver will detect the modification to the payload or the modification to the TCP option. It will terminate the affected subflow, and the data will be re-injected over the other subflow, and the connection will continue. So next slide, please. So what are the building blocks? For that, we need to use a secure handshake, and we did not look at the handshake in detail, so we assumed that an handshake like TLS 1.3 could be reused to negotiate the keys. And then once you have negotiated the keys, then we use AEAD to be able to secure the data, and we use it to securely encrypt and authenticate both the data and the multipass TCP options that are important. Next slide, please. So basically, for that, we need to place authentication information. And given the available space in the TCP options, we cannot put the authentication information inside the multipass TCP option, and we had to put in the payload. Next slide, please. So there was an animation that will not go very well, but typically the idea is that when we have to encrypt the data, then we will use AE. You are moving to the PowerPoint?
Do you want me to?
Yeah, if you can move to the PowerPoint, that would be easy. So first, to authenticate and encrypt the data, we use AEAD like TLS would do. So we create the ciphertext based on the secret key. So that's a normal operation that any secure protocol would do. And then to authenticate the MPTCP options, next slide, then what we do is that we will use the MPTCP information as associated data in AEAD, along with a tag which is computed by AEAD for the plaintext, and we will compute with AEAD an authentication tag of the options so that the receiver can verify that the MPTCP options have been transported correctly and that there is no reinjection of data. Next slide, please. So this solution has been designed and implemented. So the implementation is against Linux kernel 4.1, and it's added to the MPTCP code. It reuses the standard Linux crypto API, and it's available on Bitbucket for those who would like to have a look at it. Next slide. So we did some benchmark in the lab with PCs connected to fast Ethernet. So all PCs, next slide. And we have decent performance when we look at throughput. So we are able to saturate the fast Ethernet, which is not a surprise. Next slide, please. And when we do request response to have short data transfer, we have similar performance as TLS, which means that the performance of the code is reasonably good for a prototype. Next slide. So to conclude, there are two parts in the presentation. The first one is that on the smartphone, we should have a look at solutions that can reduce the handover times. And from a security viewpoint, if we move in a direction where we try to merge what has been done in multipass TCP and what has been done in TCP crypt, the paper that looks at securing multipass TCP could be a starting point if we go in this direction. And I think I'm okay on time. So that was
questions,
the last
comments,
slide.
Reactions.
Julius Krabacek. I haven't read the draft, and that's the first time I hear of this work, so I'm probably saying something very stupid. Please forgive me. I'm wondering whether, in order to achieve that, you really need a whole new security mechanism. So my gut instinct would be to say just use TLS, use something that is packet format compatible with TLS, and just change the way TLS reacts to a authentication error, to an integrity error, by dropping the subflow instead of dropping the whole connection. So that would just be a change within the TLS library that doesn't require any protocol changes.
Yeah, but the difficulty with that is that TLS was designed with TCP in mind, so TLS has no notion of subflow, and TLS has no possibility of retransmitting data that was already received at the TCP level. And that's the reason why if TLS received invalid data, so this invalid data has been acknowledged at the TCP level, and TLS has no way to retransmit this invalid data. So you would have to put retransmission inside the TLS library then. And so, which means that you need to have acknowledgments at the TLS level.
Okay, so that would no longer be TLS. It would be an extension to TLS, but wouldn't that be a more parsimonious solution than a whole new security protocol?
Yeah.
Alan Ford, when you do the retransmission on the other subflow, what changes does that require to what protocols? Because presumably that requires changes on the TLS side. Make that work?
No. So what do you mean in the solution that I presented, or in TLS?
The earlier slide. Let's go back to the slide.
The MPTCP secure. In MPTCP Secure, basically, what you do is that you will check the authentication information every time you receive data before you transmit an MPTCP acknowledgement. So if you receive data which is invalid with an invalid authentication record, then you don't acknowledge it, and it will be retransmitted over another subflow reinjected by the classical MPTCP techniques.
Gotcha. Okay, that's quite nice. Thanks.
So I mean, this is a change. This would be a change to the BIS to add this in. So I guess it needs to be described.
Well, it wasn't clear to me what the actual protocol changes were with this, because that bit wouldn't require any protocol changes. So I'm not sure what bits would do. Olivier.
For the security part.
So this
part,
slide.
This is a
what bits
change
of what you presented? So what bits of what you presented? Anything on the wire or in the protocol?
So the first.
It was a data one.
So I think the part makes sense to be included in the BIS version. And the MPTCP secure part is something for the work that we might want to do once, if we want to integrate TCP crypt inside multipath TCP.
So we're not clear what, for this smartphone part, what change to the BIS is required.
So this slide that we're looking at, is this MPTCP secure?
No, this is not.
Okay. So we've had three different things, so I'm getting very confused as to which bit is which. What needs any protocol changes here, then? I don't see anything that needs a protocol change.
Not on this slide, but if you go two slides later, if you want to put data inside the scene with mpjoin, then you will need to do something.
Yep. Is that necessary to make the security work, or is that just for the improvement in latency?
That's improvement for the handover, to have a fast handover. Because if you go to the next slide, what you would like is that you would like to be able to accept the reinjected data immediately when you receive the MP join. But you cannot do that.
Okay.
If you don't have information in the scene plus MP join that allows you to authenticate the data, because you don't want to have replay attacks and things like that. But we can talk about that offline.
Okay.
So what worries me a little bit is that we seem to reinvent the wheel again for MPTCP specifically, because it's a little bit like fast open, right? And we have TCP crypt, and like, do we have to do this all once again for MPTCP?
So looking at fast open, if we want to do fast open inside the MP join, then the fast open solution does not really make sense, because we have state between the two hosts, while in fast open you don't have state between the two hosts. So I think it makes sense to have an MPTCP solution which is specific, because in fast open you want to send the first data of the byte stream inside the scene. In here in MPTCP, what you want to do is that you want to send data which is in the middle of the byte stream. So you have sequence number information to be placed in the MPJOIN as well. So you cannot simply reuse the fast open solution in MPJOIN.
Okay.
Olivia, Austin,
go ahead.
Hey guys, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, so two comments. First, on the mobile improvement to MPTCP, I think that's a great idea. Actually, I will present some slides that request for the exact same modification to be able to send data on the MP join. It's needed in many cases, probably. Secondly, on the security part, as far as I understand, the use case is that you negotiate TLS over one path, and then you want to protect against man-in-the-middle attacks on the other paths. But the solution Olivia presented has this problem that, let's say, I have a man-in-the-middle on the first path, and there's a rogue certificate, and someone actually man-in-the-middles my TLS connection. So what I have now is I have a key with the attacker, and the attacker has a key with the other guy. Okay, now I send the data I send over the attacker will be fine, will be accepted by the remote end, and it will be said it's good. Now, if I use any other subflow that doesn't pass through the attacker, then basically this will use a key that the server doesn't know, and the server will just reject the data. Okay, so the effect of what Olivier is proposing is that in this particular attack, you will simply drop the data that's not passing to the attacker, and all the data will be pushed through the attacker, which doesn't seem like a good outcome. I don't know if I was clear.
If you have an attacker on one pass, you will stop using the pass where the attacker has modified data, so you will move the traffic to the pass where there is no attacker.
But if there's a path on the key exchange, which is normally how you attack TLS, you basically have a rogue certificate and you do man in the middle on the first path, then that's the only path that actually works. You cannot send data on any other path because there is no shared key between the client and the server, right? You can only go via the attacker.
Yeah, but if you look at the smartphone case, for example, then you could create a VPN session over LTE, which is secure, and then you continue your VPN session over any Wi-Fi, and if there is an attacker on the Wi-Fi, then you just drop the Wi-Fi and move to the LTE when you have an attacker. So I think it makes sense in some scenarios to have a negotiation on a pass which is safe, but which is more expensive. And so you don't want to use it for all the packets.
So I'm just saying that it depends a lot on what the properties of the key exchange mechanism you use. So I'm not saying this is a good or bad mechanism. I'm just saying that if you just use standard single path TLS, then you could end up helping the attacker in some cases and not hurting him, right? So in the next presentation, I will show some possible key exchange that gives you better protection than TLS. But I don't know what that key exchange will do with your proposal.
Okay.
Thanks.
Just trying to find your slides, Justin. There you go.
Oh, great.
So what I think my summary from that discussion is that certainly the first idea of including some data on the MP join SIN, it certainly seems to be worth writing that idea up in an email or a short draft and seeing if the support for it when we've actually got a proposal written up. And given that would have to go in the BIS, I'd encourage you to do it as soon as you can, please, so that we can. I'm quite happy to, if we can organise an interim call specifically on that topic. I prefer not to have to wait to Prague, the meeting in Prague in July before we kind of reach consensus on it, if that's possible. Mia.
Mia Kulevin again. So I'm putting this in the BIS. Is maybe even a separate question because I would like to see some experimentation on that part because there is a mailbox that block data on SIN packets, so you need some kind of fallback or whatever. Right. I think it's a useful change, but there are some complications there, so maybe some experimentation might be needed here.
Okay, let's talk about that.
Yeah.
Right, Kostin, your slides are on the screen.
Great. Next slide, please. All right. So, as probably everyone knows, opportunistic encryption is being standardized at the ATF. There's a version of TCP Crypt that's being worked on in TCP Inc. And this is based on Diffie-Hellman. The idea was, how do you authenticate the guy you're talking to? And how do you have a secure key? So basically, you send these two public keys over the wire. The client generates A, which is a secret key, sends G to the A, which is a public key. The server replies G to the B, and then they have a secret key. So, the idea is that this is secure as long as you don't have an active attacker. So as long as there's no one in the middle actively changing packets, after the handshake terminates, you're guaranteed to have a secure key that you can use, and nobody can snoop afterwards. Next slide, please. So, of course, if you have an active attacker, what the active attacker can do is it can generate its own secret key, and basically you can use it to communicate with the client and the server. So using this key, you'll have two keys in use. You know, the client will use a key K1 to communicate with the attacker, and the attacker will use K2 to communicate with the server. So, you know, and this is a fundamental problem of Diffie-Hellman, and TLS, the way it tries to solve this problem is by having the server prove that the key that he sends is actually, you know, it's the servers and not some man in the middle guy. So this is what certificates are for. But again, certificates can be faked, so it's not a complete solution. Next. So the question we asked in this work that started a couple of, I guess, 1 year and a half ago was, you know, can we somehow use the multiple paths that exist between endpoints to make the attacks harder, to make these man-in-the-middle attacks harder? Next slide, please. And basically, let's just say we have two paths between the client and the server. Let's assume for now that the paths are disjoint. There's a whole discussion that we can have if you want on how disjoint the paths really are. And basically, we say we have one attacker on each path, and we define the capability of the attacker as being passive, or P, or active, A, in this particular case. And we also distinguish the cases when the attackers can communicate in real time, so when they see the client traffic, or they can't communicate in real time. They could communicate offline before the attack or after the attack, but not during the attack. So you have weakly connected attackers and strongly connected attackers. Next slide, please. Okay, so what this leads you is this threat hierarchy where depending on how strong the attackers are, you could have, for instance, two passive attackers that can't communicate at the top of the hierarchy. Then as you go down, you have some attackers that can communicate, but they don't, that can actively modify packets, but they don't communicate and so forth. And finally, the strongest attacker is having two active attackers that can communicate in real time. And you know, the way you should read this attack hierarchy is that the thing at the bottom is the most powerful attacker, and then every line points to a weaker attacker than the one the line is originating from. Next slide, please. Okay, so basically what we did in our work is that it's proved that solving, you know, giving a solution for this AA attacker that with active communication is impossible. In essence, this is because they behave as a single man in the middle, you know, on all paths. It's almost like the single path case. However, in all other scenarios, so either you have active attackers that don't actively communicate, or you have at least one passive attacker, we provide this protocol, which we call SMKEX, that basically ensures that you either get a secure key or the protocol fails and tells you it has failed. Next slide, please. So I won't go into the details of why, you know, this is the right protocol. We have a paper that I can share it with people if you want. It's under submission actually now. So the idea is this. So let's say the client has addresses A1 and A2, and the server has addresses B1 and B2, and there's a path between A1 and B1 and a path between A2 and B2. Okay? So the client on the first path, it basically sends a nonce and its own public key, which is in this case G2DX. And on the second path, it just sends the same nonce, right? So it's basically nothing more than a nonce. The server on the top path will reply with its own secret key and its own nonce. And on the bottom path, it will reply with this authenticated encryption of a hash of all the messages it had seen or sent on the top path, right? So intuitively, on the top path, we're just doing a standard Diffie-Hellman or TCP crypt exchange. On the bottom path, we're sending this encryption of the messages seen on the top path. Now, I will claim, and we claim that this protocol helps against all types of attackers except the active attackers that can communicate in real time. And this is because, first of all, assume the case where you have a passive attacker. And let's say the passive attacker is the guy at the bottom, okay? if on A2 the attacker cannot modify anything, that basically means that the authenticating encryption sent by B will arrive unchanged at the client, and the client will see that after trying to decrypt, it will not be able to decrypt because it doesn't have the key, the shared key with B. It has a shared key with the attacker on the top path, and therefore it will fail. Now, if you have two active attackers that don't communicate, the top guy can do a proper man-in-the-middle attack as normal on Diffie-Hellman, but the bottom guy can't really do anything because it can't modify this this encrypted message because it doesn't know the secret key, right, that was negotiated on the top path. Right, so the intuition is that just by sending this encryption of a hash, you basically avoid all possible attacks that could appear, except the case when these guys are actively communicating during the attack. If they were actively communicating during the attack, it's trivial to see how you might break this protocol. So this SMKX is basically an opportunistic encryption protocol. It's very much like TCP Crypt. It just uses multiple paths. So if it has multiple paths, it will give you this extra protection. Next slide, please. Next, okay. So we also did a variant of our protocol for TLS 1.3, and the summary of it is very simple. So basically, on the top path, you do the TLS 1.3 handshake, which is, you know, send a client hello, you get server hello back without even, we don't even detail what those messages are in this particular picture. However, on the return, you know, on the bottom path, you send again an authenticated encryption of a hash of all the messages you sent on the top path. Right, you've seen and sent on the top path, and again, you can use this information to basically verify that nothing has gone wrong on either path. Right, so basically, what the client will do is after it gets these, it won't decide anything until it gets both messages. So if the attacker just withhold messages, that then the client will just wait forever, or after the timeout decides the connection cannot be done. So after it gets both messages, if it the client will basically use the top path to compute a secret key, and use that secret key to decrypt the bottom path message. And if the message, the hash it gets, is a correct hash of the stuff it's seen on the top path, then we have a secure key. Otherwise, we declare a failure and the protocol stops. So again, we can prove that this protocol gives you more protection than TLS because basically it will protect you against rogue certificates on one path, right? So if you have an attacker, say some hotspot provider that man-in-the-middles you, even if they have a good certificate, a certificate that your browser or your machine accepts, as long as they don't also control the alternative paths you have, say Wi-Fi, and don't communicate in real time with that path, then you still catch them. Next slide, please.
Kostin, can you try and wrap up in the next 5 minutes?
Sure. Next slide, please. Okay, so in a nutshell, what this gives you, it basically gives you protection. For TLS, it gives you protection against rogue certificates. For opportunistic encryption, it allows you to get away with the case when you have one passive attacker communicating with one active attacker, or active attackers without communication. Next slide, please. Next. Okay, so basically, I just want to highlight why it's important to be able to send data on the join. So we've implemented we've implemented the SMKX over NPTCP. And what we basically do is we open the first subflow. As soon as the first subflow finishes, we can start the handshake on the first subflow. However, before we can start the handshake on the second subflow, we need to do the MP join. So we have to wait for the MP join for one full RTT for the MP join to be for the additional subflow to be set up, and only then we can send the data that we need to send on the second subflow. So the key will only be computed when the second RTT on the second subflow finishes. So of course, if you could send data on the syn join, next slide, we could have this basically where we would cut a full RTT, and that would be great. So basically, I would like to join Olivier in saying that, you know, being able to send data on DMP join is, you know, I think it's really useful for many use cases. So yeah, we'd also like to have that in the biz, ideally. Next slide, please. So okay, so we've implemented this. It's still not complete. So I just had some results from my student today. It's basically just about working. We've added some API to subflow preference API to MPTCP. So it's not big changes. Next slide. So to summarize, if you do have disjoint paths, you can use them to get much better protection than you do when you have a single path and do Diffie-Hellman, or when you have a single path and do TLS, right? So intuitively, for an attacker to be able to crack this new protocol, it needs to be active on all paths, and it needs to be actively communicating. So let's say, I don't know, I'm on Wi-Fi and LTE. So my operator needs to be able to coordinate with my cable provider, and they need to actively attack my connection during the handshake phase. Otherwise, they won't be able to break the connection, even if they can fake certificates. So okay, so this is a proposal, and we're planning to take this to you know, the security working groups at the next IETF. But the reason I'm presenting this now is because it's sort of an urgency to try to get this SynJoin plus data in the biz, and this is, you know, yet another good use case. So yeah, with that, I'm done. I'll take questions. Thanks.
Question.
Alan Ford, could you expand a little on what you would need as a protocol change for this? And Olivier also, if he wants to jump in here, are we just talking about essentially a data sequence mapping for the SYN? So this says the payload for this, yeah, well, it is a data sequence mapping, but for the SYN, yep.
Yeah? Yeah, basically, but then I guess we'd have to revisit the security assumptions we've made when we designed the join mechanism. Like, what was the reason we had to wait like for a full RTT before being able to send data, right? Because if you think about it, we already have some security association with the remote end, so it seems very conservative what you did. I mean, given that people send stuff over TCP in the first RTT these days, this seems overly conservative to me. And you know, regarding Miria's comment that some boxes drop data with SYN, I would argue that that's a much smaller problem with MPTCP than it is with TCP, because at the end of the day, a subsequent subflow dropping in 0.1% of the cases is no big deal, right? It's just a subsequent subflow. You just lose some reliability. You typically still have like other subflows that work, right? So in a sense, if the cost of this is to have the possibility of some small fraction of secondary subflows dropping, I'm willing to live with that. Or we could basically do some setsock opt that says I want aggressive joins or non-aggressive joins. I mean, either solution is fine.
Okay, so with data on the SYN, the rest of this is done in the application layer. That's what you're saying, unless the key exchange and everything. Yeah, okay. Thanks.
Mia Kulivan, to add to my previous comment. So I agree, Kostin, like in the previous case, it was where you have a handover and then you would lose connectivity, but you can probably give different recommendation for these different cases.
So maybe I'd encourage the people who are interested in having data on the MP join to write something up that people can comment on. And if people feel they can already comment on it, please do it before. And so we can easily organize an interim for people to discuss that in more detail once it's actually written up.
Thank you.
Yes, I wanted to answer to Mircea because putting data inside the MP join is an optimization. If you have a middle box that would remove the data in the MP join or that would block the MP join with data, then you would retransmit the MP join without data, and so you would incur some delay, and then you would retransmit the data later inside as a normal data over the MPTCP connection. So it's possible to cope with those middle boxes that would interfere with MP join plus data.
Any more on this? Okay, so in that case, we are, let's just check where we're up to. So we may already have had this discussion about how to complete the BIS. I think we probably talked about most of these points already. So we know we've got to have complete agreement on the items that Alan talked about, and we had some good news from Christoph on the implementation front, and then we've got this point that's just been raised that we need to work that out, since if people like it, it should be in the BIS document. That would be my reaction anyway. Okay, so as you can see from the bits we highlighted in red, we have taken a long time from our original intention to progress the BIS. So it would be really nice if we can try and complete it in the next, Prague meeting or soon after. We really think that we're getting there. Don't want to be in the same position in another 5 years' time of where we haven't quite finished it. So, as I say, we're very keen to try and complete it, very keen to, for people, these new additions, get it written up, at least in a draft outline, as quickly as possible, to have an interim talk about it on the audio, and to really see if we can wrap this thing up in Prague would be perfect. Obviously, we need implementation of the BIS before, because this is on the standards track, the BIS, so that was going to require an implementation of actual the BIS stuff. There's lots of implementations of the original RFC, but we clearly need an implementation of the BIS before we can progress on the standards track. So we really are looking to try and, to try and wrap this up in the near term rather than the distant term. Excellent. So, assuming there's no more on the BIS,
since Mircea is here, if you have any feedback for changing security mechanism from SHA-1 to SHA-256, could you give some comments or feedback? Okay. So, since we are thinking about using SHA-256 instead of SHA-1 in BIS draft, and I would like to know how to proceed this one. We just modify the draft and submit to IEC. Is that okay? Or you want to have any additional security review beforehand? You don't get it. So.
And what's the question?
Okay. So we are thinking about changing this one, and then before we change it, we would like to ensure if this is the right approach, additional review or not.
You don't need, but if you want to be sure, there's a security directorate, and you can just ask them for an early review.
So, I think you wrote, if I remember right, you wrote to the security ADs, and right, we didn't get a email response. So, should we just
you
send
did,
it? To,
or?
No. Should we just resend it because they've been too busy?
So, I mean, like the security directorate, they will anyway do a review in IETF last call. So you will get feedback. But if you are worried that there's a problem, which I'm not, then you can ask for an early review. And then there is like somebody like the chair of the security directorate who actually is the person to talk to. So this is a different email address and you will find it in some wiki. Let me know if you can't find it.
So next up on the agenda is Joseph. So this is some nice experimental results, which should be really interesting.
Right. So I'm Joseph Isaac from NASA. There's a colleague of mine, Matt, who's in the audience, hiding back there, way in the back. And I'll be talking about some work we're doing for the Earth Science task under NASA, and I'll get into that. Next slide, please. So quick background, we're using iridium modems for this task, and I'll get into the features of that in a second. Quick background on why that is just one of the main reasons is just using it for polar areas, so Arctic or Antarctic missions. It was a choice, and they use it for other missions as well. The system is used for talking to the folks on the crafts, like scientists. So this is payload, not controlling the airplane or anything like that. But the key thing to take away is that there are researchers on the ground trying to reach the researchers on the craft and send data up. And there are also connections that are coming from the craft down. So there are actually connections originating from both sides going in both directions. So, and they're using both TCP and UDP in both directions. So currently they use a system that uses MLPPP and uses four links. And next slide. So the here's a quick picture of what the architecture looks like. Again, we have people on the aircraft, which is what we call the payloads, and the users on the ground. And there are several of these modems again. And key thing is that there's right now what they call a SATCOM server or a resource on the aircraft that controls those modems airborne. And then a piece of equipment on the ground that actually is just a modem bank and is where all the equipment data comes in. Next slide. So what is this iridium modem? What is it like? Why do we have multiple of them? These links actually are really slow. They're 2.4 kilobits each. So in order to get any kind of speed is why they bond, want to use multiple links at the same time. So right now four gets you 9.6. You can see why they have an actual desire to go more than four to like eight or even 12, because that gets them to an even more reasonable number to try to get more capacity into the system. On top of that, these links they aren't stable. They go down fairly often. I'll show that in a second. But they're essentially like cell phones where they can either degrade, lose a bit of information, and the call is still active, so you'll lose something, but you'll still be there, or they'll drop out completely, like you drop a cell phone call. So there are the one last bit is that these links, because of all their speed and everything, are also very slow. It takes about 2 seconds for round trip time for just a SIN and four for a 500 byte MTU. Next slide. So here's a test flight that we actually did with MPTCP, and it gives you an idea of how the links change. The top of this plot shows the number of active calls and links going on. So you see at the start of the flight, we start at zero and then go up to four and then fluctuate in between there. I won't get into the bottom plot, but it shows each link individually. Green is basically packets that made it across. Red are the ones that got dropped. Next slide. So to summarize that chart, it was 13 hours of flight data, of which there were 325 transitions from different link states. So that's 25 changes an hour, and only a little over 75% of the time do we actually have everything working up, and you got that 9.6 kilobits per second. So with that much degradation, and that doesn't even include the red lines that you saw, that was just the active call. So we have a lot of links coming and going, and the quality isn't that great on top of it. Next slide. So our thought was, what can we do with MPTCP? And our goal was to take and minimize the impact to both the payload and the user. So we don't really have that much control to touch all of them. There are potentially 20 payloads on this aircraft at any one time. To go and ask them all to upgrade to MPTCP was too much to ask right now. So we said we're going to issue it on both just the server in the air that touches the modems and the ground server that has the modem bank on the ground. And that had a minimal impact, and we had direct control over those boxes. In addition to that, we were going to attempt to use more than four modems. Next slide. So in that setup, we had to get around a few of MPTCP's limitations. As you guys know, that you need to have some idea of the current paths right now when you're using MPTCP, and you also have to be MPTCP aware on both ends to have this work. So in this setup, if we did put MPTCP on the source and destination, that path wouldn't be able to really benefit because the source and destination wouldn't know the number of paths in the middle of the network. So so we had to try to find a way around this. Next slide. The solution that we approached was to use service-specific proxies, and that was by basically analyzing the services that they needed on the craft. In this case, the things they cared about the most were web traffic and IRC traffic, which is how they communicated with each other. And so we ended up just standing up a SQUID proxy on each box and a IRC server on each box. And if I go to the next slide, kind of visualize what that meant. So now the people on board the aircraft would talk regular TCP to the SATCOM server. That would in turn speak to the other proxy with MPTCP, and that would then speak regular TCP to its final destination. So it was splitting up the connection three ways. Next slide. So we ran into an initial issues with the current implementation that we had to overcome as well. And the first issue is that is just trying to configure the setup. So we did the natural thing. Okay, we have four interfaces on each side, and we give each an IP address. And in the Linux implementation, you pick a path manager, we picked full mesh. That works, except that it also tries to spin up additional subflows to that actually cross-link. So these are point-to-point interfaces. We didn't actually want or need subflows from one point-to-point interface to the one that didn't to a non-corresponding interface. So we didn't want one to go from PPP0 to PPP1. That wasn't something we needed. So one way around that was to just try to use IP tables and block those. That can get cumbersome. On top of that, the implementation actually has a hard limit as to the number of subflows it will spin up right now, and that's just something that's internal to the implementation, but that would limit us right now to only four total of these interfaces. Next slide. So our approach was to say, hey, instead of using four IP addresses or N IP addresses on the ground side, we'll actually just back it off to one. That actually worked really well. From the aircraft down, it would spin up the right number of subflows. However, from the ground up, using the default now on the ground path manager, it's more of the passive path manager, so it wouldn't spin up any additional flows if you tried to connect going from the ground upwards. So next slide. So okay, fine, we'll go now to full mesh on the ground, and that actually worked great. So seemed all fine until we lost one of the links, and then that remove address got spun up for one of the IP addresses on the ground. And what the implementation did and what the spec kind of says is you should then not use any flows associated with that IP address, which happens to be all of them. So they would all go away once you lose one link. So since the remove address is kind of optional in the spec, we asked about patching it. And next slide. And Christoph was very quick, and thank you, Christoph, for providing a patch that helped us to suppress those remove addresses. And that worked really well, and the system performed as I expected, and it actually worked really well. And I have that in the next slide. So this is MPTCP trace that we actually have some software that we brewed in-house to generate the time sequence graph. Sorry, I'm just blinking. So this is a time sequence graph that shows the segments in different colors for each subflow. And there's actually a communal ACK line in there too that you can't really see. But that's for, again, all this is all MPTCP level. And at the beginning there, you have two subflows, and then we drop down to one, then we work back up to two, then three, then four, and I superimposed a gray line there to kind of give you an idea of how MPTCP is adjusting and reacting as the subflows drop out in one case and then come in, and it actually worked really well in terms of utilizing the available capacity of the link. So in this setup, this is a web connection. And this is, I think, almost 10 minutes worth. So they had basically web connection trying to grab 110K. It would take minutes. And as the links were coming, going, it stayed steady enough. So using the proxies and the setup that we had. Next slide. So overall, MPTCP really worked for our setup. It helped us out, helped keep the connections healthy and long-lived, which basically greatly improves the perception of the user in terms of stability. In the past, they had tried to, you know, grab things off the web, or and they would time out, or their IRC channel would drop out. And again, this is from the impact. When you're using MLPPP, you bond all the channels together, and your control loops are all combined as well. So MPTC really helped us split out the control loops, helped isolate losses to the link just in question, and keep losses to the respective path. And as links would come back, it would take advantage of that and rejoin into the overall connection, making use of the available capacity that was added. So the other point to take away is that the service-specific proxies, basically the proxies set up on each box, actually worked really well. We know that's not a completely scalable solution. There are some applications like SSH, if they showed interest in, and would not, you know, be as easy to stand up as some of these other services. But for that that three, the regular TCP, MPTCP, regular TCP actually worked really well. And the last thing that we didn't show, but was pretty. Pretty funny. At one point, they got so happy with the setup, they tried to get ambitious, and they tried to open up a regular web browser that tried to fetch a regular web page that had all sorts of objects and CSS and everything, and fired up 20 connections. And when you're at 9.6 kilobits per second, that still doesn't work well. So, no matter what technology you're using. So, next slide. So finally, what I want to close on is some implementation issues we observed. Right now, they were looking to use more than, 8 to 12 of these interfaces, but the implementation actually has hard limits as to the number of interfaces you can use, and also has that limit on subflows. Now, of course, these are just limitations in the implementation. But just something that there are for other implementers and stuff to know, and hopefully something that we'll work on fixing here in the future, is that there are potential use cases where you want many of these. So don't, keep that in mind. And another observation that we had is that when you spin up, when we had in the lab 8 interfaces and tried to add them, the add addresses were actually being sent out in many duplicate acknowledgments. So TCP starts up that first subflow. You say, I have 7 other addresses to use, and you want to tell the other side. It would actually try to fit these into the messages, and in this case, fired off several acknowledgments. Well, there's potential concern that might trigger. I know you're not, by spec, you're not supposed to trigger fast retransmit, but maybe some thought needs to revisit that the handling of fitting all those options into the limited TCP option space, that maybe there's some need for EDO or something else in this protocol that would help increase that. Because in our case, there's potential use for SAC2 and other options that the additional space may help. And maybe some interactions, again, with how fast retransmit or any other TCP mechanisms will react to the dupacks. And of course, and the last note on that is that to us, we actually, since our round trips times are so long, it was nice to be able to fire them all off. So the option of just waiting for another round trip time, or like, okay, well, here's the one set and then wait it, and then here's the other set, wouldn't be too attractive to us. We want to get them all out as fast as we can. So, and then finally, the last note is the remove address behavior. When you have a machine that has multiple interfaces but a single address, there's language in the draft now that says you should try to probe or whatnot. We'd like to kind of shed some light on that. If you have that scenario, a remove address has to be carefully checked before you just take it out. So, or take all the subflows that relate to it out. And I think that's it. Any questions?
So I'm Julius Krobacek. And so first, I think there's a mistake in your slides. On slide 16, you say that MPTCP is not magic. Okay, I strongly disagree with this.
Okay.
Other than that, I belong to a certain sub-religion here, which is the sub-religion of proxies are evil, that sometimes gets me into trouble. And you said that you were using proxies because your multiple links were not directly connected to the endpoint.
Correct, that they didn't know the end path, plus they weren't MPTCP capable
so
yet.
So MPTCP doesn't need to be connected to all the endpoints if your routing infrastructure is done right. And I think that the technology you're looking for here is something that's called source-specific routing, or SADR, and for source address-dependent routing. And I think we might, well, if you want, we could have a chat about that later, and they'll give you
I'll make one note, and I think my colleague is going to make another. The proxies were explicit. They weren't transparent proxies. They were specifically pointed to the proxy
as part of their evil.
So the other thing is, I'm not sure that the source, if Matt has a comment, I'll let him comment now on that. But we'd have to talk, but I don't think it'll quite work.
Just, hey, Matt Sargent, just a quick thing. My task was literally to try to figure out to make MPTCP work over already, and like that was my job description. So while there might be better technologies for it, that was sort of what I was tasked with. Even if we could get MPTCP at the end hosts, we still have a problem with sort of, I think the best option right now is like NDIF ports or something. They say, oh, we'll use four NDIF ports for the path manager. Say, oh, spin up four subflows, and then we could sort of guide them nicely over our different Iridium links. It's sort of to keep our control loops one per satellite link. Unfortunately, when we lose a link, there needs to be some coordination to say, hey, like you can easily reset a subflow, right? If you start off with four and you go down to three, you could get rid of one, but then you need to still say, hey, a path came back up in the middle, you know, fire up a new one. And sort of if we leave all the subflows there, they quickly converge to being all over one link and sort of step on each other very quickly. So I'm sure there might be better solutions overall, but as far as exploring possible MPTCP-based solutions, it worked out pretty well. I mean, it's not a final solution yet. But.
And our goal actually would be to eventually go to a solution where the source and the destination both had MPTCP enabled. And I would love to get rid of the proxies. However, there's still a lack of, now, unless we manually go in there and configure, hey, you, Mr. Payload, who has no idea how many Iridium links were set up in the middle, use 4 or 8 or 12. There has to be some kind of either manual intervention, which is what we're trying to avoid in this case, where I try to statically set some number. And if somebody just randomly goes, or not randomly, but just, you know, this today we have 4 less than we had thought we had because of a hardware failure. Somebody has to remember to go change that bit. We want to avoid that kind of manual intervention on these flights. So I'd love to get into a situation where we're MPTCP on both ends and have the right number of slump flows spin up and go over those paths. But I think we're not there yet with the current state of things.
So yes, it looks like an interesting problem. So just to clarify, source-specific routing is an addition to MPTCP.
Okay.
It is the routing technology that makes MPTCP really magic.
Okay, I'll have to take a look.
In addition
closer
to
look. MPTCP. Okay.
Matt Sargent, one more comment. Just it was about, I don't know, maybe a year ago or so, but playing around with source routing in the Linux build didn't seem to always do what I thought it was going to do. And that's, you know, if you sort of follow the guidelines on the MPTCP website, you can get some interesting results with which packets are actually going over which path, to the point where even though you think, oh, from this IP address should always go down this path, you would actually see some weird kind of cross-routing behavior, and then things would get dropped or sometimes routed, you know, later on down the line. So I don't know if it's been updated since then, but.
Okay. Any other questions?
That's it. Thank you very much.
It's
very
you.
Interesting.
Hello, everyone. My name is Kian from NICT Japan. So today I would like to present a simple idea by using scene duplication to improve performance for MPTCP. Next slide, please. So first of all, I will reintroduce the problem we addressed and how to solve it very briefly. And we also present some recent evaluation results, and finally, its conclusion. Next slide. So, in the draft, we address a known problem with multipath TCP, that is, the performance is depend on the selection of the first path. And to solve that problem or to improve the performance, we use scene duplication. And we present detail in the next slide. So this slide shows the default or in the standard now and our proposal in the left figure, as you can see, multipath TCPU sequential initialization. That means, as someone mentioned, they have routing, sort routing information in the host, and they do the first handshake successfully and then do the second one. And MPTCP has no choice. Yeah, it's depend on the default gateway on the host, for example. And we just propose to use the routing information to send the scene concurrently at the same time. And to do that, the performance will be better, as we will see in the next slide. So we actually implement the idea, and we evaluate in the simplest scenario, as you can see in the slide, with one client, one server connect via two paths. And the path two, which is not associated with the gateway, is a fixed, and the other path have a different value of delay. And we compare in, we call two scenario, uplink and downlink. For uplink scenario, actually we send IPERP, but in 10 seconds to send to the server. And for downlink, we download a file with different size from the server. And next slide, please. And we show the results here. Actually, yes, the average X condition have 10 experiment, and the value is every maximum and minimum of them. And we would like to say that with scene duplication for the average or long flows, even throughput is a little bit better. Next one, please. And for the downlink scenario, actually we download many different file size from the server, and we saw only two cases here with 1 megabyte and 4 megabyte file size, and it's a kind of source flow. And we compare the download time, and as you can see with the scene duplication or with our proposal, the download time is significantly reduced. And by that, I went to the conclusion. Yeah, we introduced a simple idea, but it worked, and we implemented, it improves the performance of multi-party TCP in the evaluation scenarios. Thank you, and that's it.
Thank you.
Comments?
Yeah, Lars, I got so I'm it's been a long day, so I'm probably missing something fundamental. So I'm really surprised that you saw such huge throughput gains. I would expect that you see some better latency at startup, but I don't see why they translate into like factor 5 to 10 performance differences. Can you elaborate a bit more?
Oh, which performance?
So you're measuring throughput, right? And yeah, for example, here, right, it's drastically better. It's like
previous slide. It's slightly better.
Okay, but what's on the next slide? And you also
it's a download time.
But it's the same as
2 seconds.
Oh, okay, so okay. Got it. Okay, it's only a few windows worth, and that's why it's faster.
Vinicius Fortuna, Jigsaw, Google. Have you considered this for censorship circumvention? I think this could be like very cool. Like if you're in China or some places, the sensor may just like send one of the paths to like a black hole. But if you have like the direct path and like a path through a proxy, then you could benefit from like direct access when it's not censored, and alternate path when it's not censored. So it seems like you could use this idea in this case too.
Yes, it could be the case, but actually our main motivation for this kind of idea is we have a very high throughput and low latency wireless interface, which is for next generation wireless networks. And we combine with the current wireless one, and but the new wireless interface have many disadvantages. For example, it's not available on the time because of short distance. So that's why we need such kind of concurrent initialization. But for your suggestion about censorships, I would not see have a direct relationship with this kind of mechanism because it's just inside the protocol.
Mia Kulevin, I believe if you can just send data on the synjoin, you get the same effect, don't you?
If you look carefully, in many cases, we even don't need the synjoin. So can you go back to the slide 4 or 3 before that?
Yep.
Yes, this one. If you have only 2 subflow, you even don't need synjoin.
So, but if I'm talking about the left case here, if you have the left case and you could send data on the synjoin, wouldn't that give you the same performance benefit?
I am not sure because anyway, for the left side one, you need to finish the scene act first before doing this the scene join.
Alan Ford, I'm still concerned, and I said this in Seoul, I'm still concerned on the right-hand side of this diagram with potential security implications of this. Because what you're proposing there is that 2 SINs using MP-capable can become 2 subflows within an existing connection. And that means that someone could duplicate the SIN rather than go through and do the full handshake in order to get onto the second path. And I don't like that. I'm not sure what, you know, I haven't got a strong feeling of quite how it could be exploited yet, but it feels concerning. Have you done any security analysis of this?
Actually, as I said before, we have not done it yet. And we also get the same comment from Olivier. And also, we hope that we will have the update soon. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, security is a major concern in Zipnik mechanism. That's.
Any more? Okay. Thanks, Kian. Interesting stuff. Right, okay, so we're now going to move on to, for the rest of our time, talking about proxies, MPTC proxies. We have a tea break at 20 past for 20 minutes. So we put together a few, I'm intending that most of the time is just people discussing. I know that Med has put together some slides which can come and talk to some of them if the discussion goes that way. But we intended just to put together a few slides to try and introduce a discussion, get everybody on the same page, make it clear what topic we're actually going to discuss today. So in terms of the reasons that multipath TCP proxies have been proposed, what scenarios there are, people have talked about them in two scenarios. One with a multipath TCP enabled smartphone, where there's a proxy in the operator's network. So there's one proxy and one endpoint that's multipath TCP enabled. And the other scenario that people have talked about is where neither endpoint is multipath TCP enabled. So there's one multipath TCP proxy in the home gateway or CPE and one distant one somewhere in the network. And that both of those devices are under the control of the operator. So today, we're going to only talk about the scenario with two proxies, one in the home gateway, one in the network, both under the control of the operator. And we're going to talk about the scenario where the network proxy, the one, the distant one in the network, is not on the default path. So we're going to confine the discussion to that. To try, the reason for doing that is we want to try and make some progress on a scenario that is of interest to people, that seems, that we selected it, it seemed the most important one that the most people were interested in. And the work that's been done so far has been kind of on all of these scenarios, and it's quite hard for other people to get their head around it quickly enough of these scenarios. So we want to try and confine it. And there's a comment at the mic. Hello, Dave.
Hi there. Dave Allen Erickson. Just a clarification question. Yeah. I agree the not on the default path is by far the more interesting case, but that does not make on the default path out of scope. Right. It's just we're just discussing focusing today's discussion.
So this is exactly a focus of today's discussion. I think the other scenarios are the other three scenarios are all of interest. So it's just for today to try and make progress on one of the scenarios rather than be in the position where we've talked about all four kind of simultaneously and we don't make progress on any. So okay. that was our hope. Whether that comes off or not, we will find out. So a slide briefly to frame it. So the idea of having these proxies is to gain some of the benefits of multipath TCP, like resilience for endpoints that don't understand multipath TCP. We're only thinking about TCP traffic. So said we're making the assumption both proxies are under control of the operator. And we are, this is in part a call for solution proposals. Our objective in the sort of medium term is to go ahead and reach consensus on one proposal that we go forward with and design in detail. We're not intending to go forward with several proposals. And in terms of whether we need a recharter, we will worry about that as and when we get consensus on what a solution might look like. Some of them would need a recharter, some of them wouldn't. Some might be done here in this group, some might not, some aspects might not. So just to again, to frame the discussion, so from an application point of view, there's two TCP endpoints exchanging TCP data. From a data flow point of view, between the two proxies, there's multipath TCP with multiple subflows running. And from a signaling point of view, the solutions involve some special signaling between the two proxies. And the objective of that signaling is to get an endpoint's address into the distant proxy so that some stuff can then happen to get the data through. So I've put together from various people have put together kind of what assumptions these solutions for this scenario make, and kind of what criteria or what requirements seem important ones. So I would, when I finished talking about this one, or when you finish reading through it, it would be good to have some discussion about this. So we've assumed the two proxies know each other about each other, things like addresses and security information. And it's assumed that the endpoints have no direct influence on, and maybe even knowledge of the fact there's an MPTCP segment. So these are some criteria that people have mentioned, features they would like the solution to deliver. We're not intending to do, don't get scared, we're not going to do any formal requirements phase, but it's important people have the same kind of criteria in mind when comparing solutions. So we want the proxies to be simple to operate. We don't want, home gateways are simple devices, network proxies, we don't want to worry too much about scaling them. They can have lots of home gateways that could be connected to them. We certainly want to limit the setup time for getting this signaling, special signaling, as I called it in the previous slide, done. Some people think that having a no round trip time solution is critical. That second sub bullet is supposed to say so zero round trip time is critical, not critical. And some people have suggested that's not so critical because MPTCP is most interesting for long running flows. So it'd be good to have some discussion around how important it is to minimize the setup time. Clearly want to limit the amount of overhead traffic on the data, amount of overhead in the data traffic, so that's processing overhead, data overhead, buffering, etc. We've got to make the solution sure that a solution works whichever end the session is initiated. That might be worth discussion as well. And there will certainly be, won't be part of the solution, but operators will want to do policy control about which connections get the multipath TCP treatment. So there has to be some policy at the proxies about that, because you may have some solutions that some connections that you don't want to get spread over multiple paths, or only use the fixed broadband path and not the LTE or whatever. And last bullet, important one at the end there, we don't want to interfere with normal multipath TCP when both endpoints are enabled, and we don't want to get in the way of those deployments happening. So does anybody have any reactions to that? I've put one where there's the setup time that I think was definitely worth some discussion, but any of those or anything we've forgotten that we should keep in mind before we dive into kind of solutions?
Stuart Cheshire, Apple. I have a question. It wasn't clear from your previous picture. You talked about the proxy being in the CPE and something else in the network. Is the assumption that there are two completely separate paths from the CPE, like does DSL plus LTE? Is that because I didn't see the multiple paths on the picture. That was like right in the middle there. Is the idea that there's multiple physical technologies?
Yes, exactly. Yep. So I've not made that clear in that picture. Yeah. So it's the scenario that people have mainly mentioned is where the home gateway has both an LTE and a fixed broadband connection. So yeah, it's two completely physically separate connections.
Christoph, Pash, in terms of the assumptions and criteria, do we also need to specify in terms of IP versions? Because the client, for example, might be in an IPv6 only network and the network proxy only IPv4. So the TCP endpoint that gets communicated to the network proxy might be IPv6 then, so he couldn't use it.
But does it affect the solution?
I think so. Yes.
So I think it's worth adding the criteria that the endpoints may be V4 or V6, and the solution should work for, in both cases. That's what you're saying, is it? Yeah, I think that's a good one to add.
Julius Krabacek, are you assuming that the physical links end at the same box, or is that not an assumption?
Yes, I think it was, yes, in my head, it was an assumption, but I don't know if it's in other people's head.
So we assume that both links end at the same physical box.
Are people happy with that assumption? It was, but there's some nodding that people want that assumption. So.
Okay. And could you please clarify the penultimate point, operator wants policy control?
By that, I meant that people have said that they want, so there's an example where, given where you might want your TV, as an operator, you might want your TV service to be only go over the fixed broadband link and not go over the LTE. That would be one example. So it's that kind of policy that you want to make sure you have some control over. So just to make sure a solution doesn't block that policy control of that ilk.
Yeah, Dave again. Yeah, just to elaborate a little bit on the policy, the notion is that certain flows would be able to be pinned to certain paths and not put over the bonded link, for example, and also would not fail over in the sort of enhanced resiliency case. You would not expect to try and preserve the IPTV service if the fixed access failed by trying to shift that service over to the wireless. Another practical example would be only using overflow on the wireless link past a certain information rate on the fixed link. So you're going to need some knobs in there in terms of how the traffic distribution policies actually work. At least I believe that would be the intention and desire.
So I don't think our group will, the working group would work on those policy controls, but we just want to make sure the solution doesn't stop that kind of policy stuff happening.
The solution should be amenable to it.
Yeah.
Or it would be desirable that the solution was amenable to it. The actual policy controls, I think, would be delivered by other means.
Stuart Cheshire again. I'm not sure whether you're just wanting questions on this slide right now or whether moving into discussion, but there's an assumption in the middle there that MPTCP is most interesting for long-running flows. And I guess I'm representing the Apple point of view here when I say the reason we used it for Siri was not because we needed more bandwidth. My view is that a lot of the time when you've got two different kinds of hardware, they have very dissimilar throughput. You might have a cable modem with 100 megabit per second connection and another link with a 2 megabit. So if you add them together, at most you're getting 102. The best you can ever get is double the throughput when you've got two equal links, and you very rarely have two equal links. So from our point of view, getting a bit more throughput is not very exciting. It is saving the latency on time critical operations. In effect, it's fast failover, that when the cable modem is down, you get very fast failover to the LTE connection, and you only needed a few kilobits anyway, so it doesn't matter. What you don't want is waiting for a timeout. So I would argue that it's the zero RTT, really fast response stuff, that is the most important, not the least important.
Okay.
Maybe I could have been to a little bit add on this case. So in this, like where you have the bandwidth aggregation case, I think it's actually not, because there's the case that you don't have a link, yet you have a service which needs a bandwidth, and like one of the one single link can't serve your service. So you have to bundle two of the links to get enough bandwidth to make the service work at all. That's the scenario.
One second, I don't buy this, because we just had the example that, you know, the TV doesn't go over both. And the TV is actually something where you might want the bandwidth. And so if the bandwidth intensive services are excluded from getting the multi-path TCP treatment, then what is included?
I think TV was a bad example, but maybe like the voice over IP shouldn't go over both because of latency. Yes, yes. But then you might not want to go over both because you have very different latency on both links. And usually you want, like, and you already know that one of the links has lower latency, so you can just choose that one. So, and like this case really gets interesting when, so because if you have multiple flows, you can also do just put one flow on one link and other flow on one. So the case gets interesting when you have like one flow which doesn't fit on one of the links.
So I suppose in terms of the importance of this limiting the setup time, the question is, if there are important use cases to minimize that setup time, then you want to minimize it. It doesn't matter if there are other use cases where it doesn't matter much. If there are important ones where it does matter, then the protocol has to do that.
I'll very briefly answer Miri's point, and then I'll let Margaret speak. I understand that adding up bandwidth gives you more bandwidth. My question is how often that is something that we really need. And my sense is that if I'm watching YouTube video and I don't have quite enough bandwidth, it gracefully steps down to a lower quality. And in the kind of applications we deal with, the application is very adaptive. And I know 20 years ago, if you had an ISDN line that was 64 kilobits, and if you had some fixed video app that used exactly 100 kilobits, not a kilobit less or more, then one ISDN line couldn't support it and you'd want to bond two together. But we now live in a world with adaptive applications, and this idea that the application either works or doesn't and bonding is the thing that makes it work. I understand the theory, I just don't see it happening in practice.
Margaret Cullen from Painless Security. I can tell you places where it does happen in practice. People who live where there's only satellite links cannot have Skype calls. Even if they had more than one link to the satellite, it wouldn't help because it would all have to fit on one link to the satellite. And I know this because Zoe's grandparents can't have Skype calls when they're in New Mexico. Okay, there's a lot of parts of the country where DSL bandwidth is very low because they're pretty far away from whatever office they have to be near in order to get high bandwidth, right? So there are those cases where one flow has to be split. The other case where you would want to split a flow is when you have like a lower speed link that is fixed cost. So it's free to use up all the bandwidth on that link, but you have a tariffed additional link and you want to get good performance, but you want to make sure that the lower speed link is completely utilized before you start using the higher speed link. And you don't know, these homes have, or environments, most of these environments where you'd want something like this have a small number of flows, and you don't necessarily know how big each of them is going to be when they start. And you have to do the address selection for the flow at the beginning, right? So if you have no way of moving the flows around, you often don't have any way of getting in, and you've got very few chunks, one of which is big and a few of which are little. You have a very hard time filling up one link and having it overflow onto another link if you can't split a flow or move a flow.
Yeah, so Nicola Leimann, Deutsche Telekom. In fact, I think it depends on the use case. I mean, whether you look on the bandwidth bundling or aggregation stuff or on the setup times, our main use case is really to basically bundle the bandwidth of two different upstream interfaces. For instance, 6+6 in order to offer the customer HD or something like that.
Okay, I'll say this quickly because I really don't want to rat hole, but I assume you've completely fixed buffer bloat in your network and you're running fkcoddl, because we know that the thing that makes internet service really, really sucky is buffer bloat. And we keep telling customers, you need to buy more bandwidth. You should upgrade to the more expensive tier. I've got 100 megabits per second. And when it sucks because of the 2-second queue in the CMTS, not because 100 megabits is not enough to do a Skype call. So this idea that we're short of bandwidth for many people is a myth, right? So I'll...
Well, I think it depends where you are with your houses and stuff like that. I mean, in our scenarios, we have many customers which are rural areas. They have 6 megabit on the fixed line. And I mean, they don't get an upgrade to 100 megabit within the next 10 years.
Let's not go too much discussion on that.
So Lars Eggert again. So something that Margaret just said confused me because it's, I think you said that when the flows start, you oftentimes don't know whether they're big or small. That seems to conflict with operator wanting policy control when the flow starts about what goes where.
I did not make these slides. I have heard, and Nick could probably come up and talk about, because I heard it from him, that there are some places where if you are a DSL provider who provides TV service, you are, due to regulatory reasons, required to send the TV service over a particular link, or I don't know if it's regulatory or law or what, you know, I'm not, or things like that. I don't. And then there's also sometimes a desire for an operator to want you to fill the links that you are actually, like, that are your fixed links, to fill your fixed links before you actually use the links that are shared by more people more dynamically. I don't know, like LTE links. I mean, it's different types of links, so it's every scenario is kind of potentially different. But yes, traffic engineering. This is more or less traffic engineering for unmanaged networks, among other things.
Joe Isaac, I just wanted to point back to the talk I had and the capacity of the links being so small. There was a lot of tuning that we had to do to buffers and stuff to prevent that same kind of queuing and delays, and that it's very hard right now to argue with that for TCP, that you auto-tuning of a TCP connection, a single one, is tough. And this is talking about multiple policies. There's a lot that can be involved to appease everybody, and just to be careful that it's a potential policy nightmare to handle some of this stuff.
So we've got 2 minutes till tea break. I've heard a couple of opinions about the setup time one, and how important it is, how important the criteria it is to minimize that setup time. I'm wondering if there's anybody else who wants to express an opinion. I mean, I've heard some strong opinions expressed to me individually, and there is one on the thing. So let's have Olivier. Go ahead, Olivier.
Yes, I think it's really key to minimize the round trip time, because when you have a connection that starts through a proxy, you don't know whether this will be a long connection or a short connection. And so you have to bet that this will be a short connection, and you don't want to delay the short connections. Otherwise, you will have bad impact on the users. So all connections should be considered as short, and they need to be handled with zero FTT impact.
Alan Ford, just to echo that, I think zero RTT is probably the most important design feature of anything proxying here, because if it's any longer than that, there's no point. It's not providing a service that's equivalent at the start. So why would people want to use it?
Yeah, it's Wim Hendricks from Nokia. I echo that, because I think if you design something new, I think given the amount of effort we are doing to reduce the amount of RTT, I think the solution will not be adopted if the solution increases the RTT time. So I think it's a very important criteria in my view.
Lars Eggert, quick chair. I just want to remind everybody that obviously once quick gets wide deployment, all of this is useless.
Might take a few years, but
So with that bombshell, it's time to have tea, isn't it? So it's 20 minutes, so we restart at 5:40 promptly. So guys, remotely, we got a 20-minute break, and we come back in 20 minutes' time.
Okay, you are now becoming a presenter. Your camera is on, Olivier.
GSL and LTE.